is to appoint a chair. Can I ask for nominations, please?
And as it's been, we should have a second now.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Robinson, thank you for the chair.
To the next item, which is nominations to the Deputy Chair, and can I nominate Councillor Gordon Freel?
Thank you.
Excellent. Is that agreed? Excellent. Before we move on to the band of formal business, and switch phones off, otherwise it's a... Absolutely. Well, one of our former members was the Mayor of Halton, so we could donate it to his charity for this year, couldn't we? So you can get your fine revenue for. But before we move on to the or whoever it was, before we move on to the full business of the committee, unfortunately, I need to sort of say a few words, because since we last met, unfortunately, we've had the very, very sad passing of Gary Ennis, who was our head of IT. And Gary had been with us for 8 years. He'd done a great job with the IT capacity and different projects here at Mersey Travel. And I think he'd really made his mark, particularly with what we're doing with smart ticketing, not just Peter, but actually with the stuff that Transport for the North are now trying to do across the whole of the north of England. So it was an absolute tragedy that we lost Gary. And obviously we send all of our deepest thoughts, prayers and condolences to Gary, all his friends and his family. Because we've not had a meeting since that terrible news, perhaps it'd be appropriate if we just stand and have a moment's silent reflection. Okay then, moving on, the third item is apologies for absence. Do we have any, Michelle?
Yes,
Chair,
you have Councillor Jackson, Pale and Williams.
Okay, commercially, I'll challenge the Chair, but suggests otherwise with all present and correct. The fourth item is the declarations of interest, and that just falls for me to remind everyone that if there's anything either they feel they need to declare now or anything crops up during the proceeds of today's meeting, during the debate, the discussion or any of the reports, please don't hesitate to indicate. We can make sure we record that declaration accordingly. Looking around, no one's indicating, so I think we can move on. The fifth item is the minutes of the last meeting. So can I move that the minutes of the last meeting, which was held on the 5th of April, are those approved as a correct record? I should sign those off in the book recording. So moving on to item six, it's the combined authority of the Constitution, the committee terms of reference, and the membership for 2018-19. Michelle, I think you're going to take us through this.
Thanks, Chair. This report is to advise the committee of the approved constitution of the combined authority, the committee's terms of reference, and the membership for 2018-19. The committee is asked to note the membership, welcome the new committee members, record its thanks to the former members, and note the sections of the combined authority constitution as detailed in paragraph 2 of the report. Thanks,
Chair. Thanks, Michelle. Before we sort of deal with the kind of key bits of business, I thought now is actually a very sort of opportune time just to say a few words about some of our retiring members, because we have had quite a few members leave us at the recent sort of district AGMs that we've had. I think we should very much mark and thank those previous members for all their kind of hard efforts. So if I go through in no particular order, but I'll start with kind of opposition first. Obviously, Les Rowlands was a long-standing Conservative representative from the Wirral. And I have to say, kind of, let's put politics aside for one moment. Les was a real, true gentleman. And I think that's one of the things that I'll certainly kind of always hold him in high regard for. I think one of the things that's also marked Les apart as well, I think this is, it really takes on board how we all should behave in politics, is his approach to constructive opposition. As an opposition politician, my God, he would oppose when he doesn't agree with something, and that obviously is how you should approach it. But where there was common ground, and there was a number of areas where we all want to move things forward, Les was very constructive in that. So I think we should sort of obviously note that accordingly. John Bradshaw was with us just for a single year as a member from Halton. He's now been elevated to the auspicious office of Mayor of Halton, so we obviously wish him all the very best for his sort of forthcoming mayoral year. Alan Jones was with us from St Helens for a year, and I think the thing that stands out about Alan is just how passionate about Rainhill, his constituency, he was. There were many occasions when quite detailed points about bus or train services that directly served his ward were obviously raised at this committee, and obviously we wish him the best for the future. We also had Mark Wynne with us for a year from Prescott. I'm aware that Mark, I think, stood down from the council now, but obviously Francis, you've now joined us in his place, so I'm sure he'll still be fully aware of all our kind of activities, and he'll be giving in the progress reports accordingly. And the other opposition member that's left us this year was Tom Crone, and he was the first Green we've ever actually had on this committee. I think, again, putting politics to one side, Tom always was very thoughtful and very informed about a lot of the issues that we deal with here, and his contribution genuinely was very much appreciated, and we wish him the best for the future accordingly. There have been a number of Labour members also retired from the committee this time around. First and foremost is Ken McGlashan, and Ken was a very, very long-standing member here at Mersey Travel. Been involved since the early 2000s, and if I was to put a list together of all the areas that Ken's been involved in and all the different things that he's done here at Mersey Travel, I think we'd probably be here at 5 o'clock tonight. I think the greatest thing about Ken is similar to Les, what a great gentleman he is. And I always think kind of Ken's a great ambassador for Knowsley and for the wider city region. There were many occasions when if we were hosting government ministers, we had a delegation from Europe once, we've had a variety of people from a variety of different places, nationally and internationally. Ken was always one of the first people up at the front selling the region and really doing that in a very kind of proud but extremely kind of diligent and sort of gentlemanly manner. So obviously we wish Ken all the very, very best for the future. Mary Rasmussen has stood down after 8 years as well. She's gone on to be Chief Whip in Liverpool for the Labour Group. I think the thing that kind of really marks Mary out is just how passionate, not just she is about her ward of Speke, but about our young people. And she really was one of the key driving forces, along with Ron and Steve, of getting my ticket in place and making sure that we got the best deal for young people on our bus network anywhere in this country outside of London, and that very much is her kind of lasting legacy that's made a big difference to a lot of our kind of most vulnerable residents in the region. Pam Thomas has also left us after a few years, and when we think about the impact Pam has had and the legacy that she will have, it's absolutely huge, because it's Pam's persistence, I think is the polite way of putting it, that David Powell, as project director of the Rolling Stock, would say, that has made sure, with our brand new fleet of trains that will be coming to the Merseyrail network, that we will have full level access from the platform onto the train. So for people in wheelchairs, people pushing buggies, people pushing bikes, dragging suitcases, anyone not just with a mobility issue, but actually just making it easier for people, we will have the most accessible railway anywhere in the country. And that is testament to Pam's very, very dogged approach to make sure that came into being. Jeremy Wolfson has also left us this year, and he's gone on to a mayoral lead role in Liverpool City Council. Jeremy is very, very assiduous, and I think has done an excellent job over his supporting Ron on the whole kind of bus agenda, and particularly doing some very detailed work about how we can utilise devolved powers to significantly improve our bus network. So Jeremy will be greatly missed by all of us. Gillian Flatley's also left us from Knowsley. Unfortunately, Gillian was dogged by some quite ill health in the past year or so, so she wasn't able to get as involved as she would hope to have done, but I'm sure she's got a very, very bright future in local politics ahead of her. Keith Deakin was with us for a year from St Helens, and he's retired this time. I always think kind of one of the great things about Keith is how steeped in kind of history he was. I'll never forget him bringing in his dad's union cards from sort of the 1920s and pointing out about how kind of things change a lot, but sometimes they don't change as much as you might think, and we'll certainly kind of miss Keith accordingly. And Gareth Cross, who was a real talent as well, has also stepped down as a council, so he's no longer with us. And I'm sure you agree with me that we wish all of those people the very best for the future. And I have taken the liberty of writing to each of them on behalf of the organisation to thank them for their service. But obviously with those that leave us, that opens up new opportunities, and we've got some real new talent that's joining us. So I'd like to give, on behalf of the committee, on behalf of the organisation, a very warm welcome to Dennis Bourne, Norman Keats and Margie O'Mara from Knowsley, Anthony Lavelle and Helen Thompson from Liverpool, Jimmy Jackson and Sue Murphy, and Jeff Pearl from St Helens, Paul Hayes from the Wirral, Chris Rowe from Halton, and Francis Byrne from Knowsley as well. So really look forward to working with all of you over this municipal year, and hopefully many years into the future as well. So I think that kind of nicely records the sort of farewells and the welcomes. There's probably a couple of other points we also need to move in terms of a motion from the floor that should be within the papers that you've got on your desk with regard to lead members. So just for completeness to read those out, the lead members for the ensuing municipal year will be Ron Abbey for Bus, Gordon Friel for Rail and Freight, Keith Roberts for Ferries and the Visitor Economy, Steve Fowkes for Finance and Organisational Development, and Natalie Nicholas for Tunnels, Highways and Key Route Network, leading John Stockton's lead member for Customer Care and Smart Ticketing. That's a motion in my name, seconded by Councillor Friel. If that can be agreed.
Agreed.
Excellent. Any other points I need to raise, unless there's any questions that want to be? Harry?
Chair, we're only beginning to note a number of the items on item six, but I think we do need to. It's not working. I think we do need to make a number of comments on this. The words in 3.4b are the references therein should be construed in this light, particularly refers to the standing orders. Well, in reality, the construction required is so great that these penalties are really not fit for purpose. And that isn't insulting the person who did them, because they're perfectly adequate for the combined authority, but when you try to make them fit with the other various committees, it just doesn't work. So I suggest that they really need to be looked at again to make sure that they are fit for purpose in that way. The second aspect of them is that the phrasing of some of the paragraphs in truth just doesn't make sense. And that doesn't, I don't mean from the point of view of the combined authority as opposed to our committee, but they just don't make sense once you have the phrases. Now this often happens, wonderful new technology where cut and paste sometimes goes awry. It does need to be looked at. And then finally, there are a number of typos. which need tidying up. I think somebody commented earlier that there have been judicial reviews which have hinged on what actually was a typo, so if we notice them, we should point them out. So I think we need to suggest that those appendices need to be looked at again, and certainly in terms of this committee, need to be amended to ensure that they do and are relevant to this committee.
Thanks, Harry. And that's a very, very important and very kind of prescient comment, because you're absolutely right. I'm going to ask Frank, in his dual role as Chief Executive of the Merseyshire, but also the interim Chief Executive of the Combined Authority, perhaps to comment on the constitution and some of the kind of developments of how it's going to be tidied up and improved.
Thanks, Mayor. I think the point's made and recognised, Councillor Howard. We had the annual meeting of the Combined Authority last week. There were a couple of minor constitutional changes that were adopted at that meeting. But we have a full review of the Combined Authority's constitution as a consequence of that, a review of the appendices to that constitution, which will pick up an awful lot of the points that you've made. And that's going to be one of the first tasks that Jill Coole will pick up when she starts as the monitoring officer for the Combined Authority on the 2nd of July.
Tony?
Thanks, thanks, Frank. In relation to the review that will take place, obviously, once that review is taking place, the orders are set before a committee. I assume it will be set before the Audit and Governance Committee of the City of Egypt to apply the governance to all the member committees.
I think any full review of the Constitution will require consultation with each of the committees forming the support bodies to the CA. So yeah, I would expect that would happen, but make sure it's being done.
Okay. Obviously, following on from the agreement for the motion that we've just received, otherwise we're happy to endorse the report and move on accordingly. That's agreed? Excellent. Moving on to item 7 is the positions on outside bodies, and I think Michelle, you're again going to quickly go through this one for us.
Thanks, Chair. This report is to advise the committee of the cycle of meetings, equipment to outside bodies and spokespersons for 2018-19. So as it says in the title, the committee is asked to agree the dates, determine the representation and individuals to serve on outside bodies, appoint spokespersons for each of the constituent district councils, and note the continuing appointments by the combined authority of the chair of the transport committee, which is detailed in paragraph 2D of the report.
Obviously, again, that's to be dealt with by a motion from the floor. So within your packs of paper, you should have the outline motion in my name, seconded by Councillor Creel, that covers most of those points. It doesn't cover the opposition members that are available for some of the outside body positions. If you know those now, you can inform us, or if you prefer, you can inform us at future date, but that's for the opposition members to decide.
Michelle,
that's fine. But otherwise, are we happy to agree that motion accordingly? Excellent. Okay, into proper transport stuff now. And item 8 is Bike Life and the Liverpool City Region. So, John is going to present the report. I know we've also got Nick from Sustrans, who's here to answer any questions as well about the report and about Bike Life in general here in the city. John, everybody, over to you.
Thank you very much, Chair. Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to be quite brief in terms of what I'm going to do. We've got quite a good video to show, which can probably explain more about what my time is about than I can. Gentleman to my left is Nick Brownsmith, who is the Partnership Manager for the North West for Sustrans, and Nick is going to be our key contact over the next 4 years as we participate in Bike Life. But more importantly, he's going to answer all the questions that you may have following this brief presentation. So, first question that you may want to ask yourselves, what is Bike Life? Bikelife started in 2015, and it was a collaboration between Sustrans and Seven Cities to basically create what's the UK's biggest assessment of cycling in cities. In February of this year, Sustrans, through their private sector fund, has got an additional tranche of money to extend Bikelife for the further 4 years for three new cities. Liverpool City Region applied, and we actually came fourth in the process. The gap between us and fourth, the City Region and fourth, and the city that was in third was so close that Sustrans, to their great credit, went back and talked to their private sector funders and managed to secure a fourth place to participate in Bikelife, and hence the Liverpool City Region now being a participating city in the programme from now until 2022. I think it's also important to stress as well that Bikelife traditionally has always been conducted at the city level. So Manchester, who are a Bikelife partner, is done in Manchester City Centre. I think for us it's the first time it's actually been tested at a combined authority level. And again, that's kind of new and exciting for us. So it says on the slide there there's now 10 cities participating in Bikelife. It's more like 14 now, isn't it, Nick, when we get everything on board. So what happens is, and again, Nick's got examples of these which he can show you. You get a report every 2 years. So our first report will be in 2020. And the report is, it's a non-technical report, so it's actually quite an accessible document. And it really looks at the cycle infrastructure vision that we will have across the city region, what travel habits are, people's attitudes towards cycling. One thing that happens in bikelife is we don't talk about cyclists, we talk about people who ride bikes. And that's a slightly different shift in a mindset, I think, and that's a really good way of looking at it. It also looks at the impact of people riding bikes. And this is fed by a survey of about 1,100 residents within the city. Because they're doing it at the city region level, we probably need to boost that survey sample a little bit around about the 1,800 to 2,000 mark. But again, we'll work that through with our colleagues from Sustrans. So what are the objectives? Well, basically, Bikelife is about normalising cycling for the city region. It's about increasing the awareness of all of the benefits that cycling can bring, make places to more livable cities. It's about securing a sustained political commitment to cycling as well over the longer term. And again, it's about encouraging this longer term planning for the provision of cycling. We're already starting to see this roll out now with the developments of local cycling and walking infrastructure plans. These longer term 10-year plans for how we're going to build more and better cycling and walking infrastructure so we can get more people travelling more sustainably. And it's also about working with our partner cities in Bikelife. You know, if a city is doing something elsewhere that will benefit us here in the city region, it's all about learning best practice. It's not often about reinventing the wheel. Edinburgh have done some fantastic stuff as part of their Bikelife participation. Manchester have, a lot of the other cities have, and we can learn a huge amount from them, and we will be doing that over the next 4 years. So why cycling? This is a good slide, it's a really good slide. What you've got at the top of the slide there are actually two quotes from one of the Bikelife reports that came out last year. And I can't even read it because that's all on the screen, but it will be in the slides when we take them out. Well, specifically for the city region, the latent demand for cycling is absolutely enormous. 66% of all of our journeys are 5 kilometres and under, yet only 2% of them are currently made by bike. The graph you can see on the other side of the screen is a piece of work that I lead on the city region, which I just mentioned is local cycling and walking infrastructure plan. The blue line you can see is the baseline, so which was taken from the 2011 census about people who did cycle at the time of the census. The red line is the cycling and walking investment strategy. And if that was fully implemented across the city region, you can see the potential for growth in cycling as a consequence. And from the research that we've done, if we fully implement the cycling and walking investment strategy, we will affect more change in the city region than we will anywhere else in the country. We're quite unique as well because we're relatively flat compared to other areas. So our geography, our topography, and our streetscape actually lends itself well to more people walking and cycling. And again, cycling also seems to sit a little bit of a silver bullet, isn't it? You know, if cycling was a pill, it would be made free on the NHS because the benefits are innumerable. And just, you know, just a couple of things there about congestion, air quality, health, transport poverty. In health alone, physical inactivity has a direct cost of about £1 billion a year to the NHS. In safety terms alone, and this is one of the big issues for us, again, with cyclists and pedestrians, the number of people get killed and seriously injured on our roads, it's cost about £11 billion a year to the NHS. City-centred environments, if you get more people city-centred environments, it's shown to have an impact on more people coming into those city centres using facilities and shopping more. So, huge benefits from being a bike lane participant. But I'm not going to say anything else because we've got a really good video to show you that Susskind had made. This is fairly new, isn't it, Nick?
This video was made for the launch of the 2017 poll, which was November last year.
Now keep your fingers crossed that the technology works. Apologies.